King Hezekiah's son, Manasseh, was only 12 years old when he became king. He was very different from his father, doing all sorts of evil things. He led the people to worship false gods, and even built an altar to Baal inside the temple of God. Things got so bad that God brought the Assyrian army against Manasseh. They put a hook in his nose and led him away to the city of Babylon as a prisoner. In his suffering, Manasseh humbled himself and prayed to God. God was moved by his prayer and allowed Manasseh to be set free and return home. For a few years, things began to improve, and the Israelites began to follow God again. They even discovered the book containing all of the laws of Moses, which had been lost for many years. The people learned once again what it was like to live in God's ways. But soon things got much, much worse. The kings who ruled over Judah once again led the people away from God. Then one day, Nebuchadnezzar, the king of Babylon, attacked the Israelites, nearly destroying the temple Solomon had built. He captured almost all of the Israelites, including the best warriors, workers, and artists, and sent them to Babylon. Only a few of the poorest Israelites were allowed to stay to take care of the fields. God sent two prophets, Jeremiah, to those left in Jerusalem, and Ezekiel to those living in Babylon. Unfortunately, the news was bad. Because they had done so much evil, God allowed the city of Jerusalem, their home, to be almost completely destroyed, and the rest of the Israelites sent to Babylon. But the prophet Ezekiel told the Israelites living in Babylon that God would not forget about them, that God would one day rescue and restore them. God even gave Ezekiel a vision that he was standing in a valley full of bones. There was a rattling sound, and the bones began to come together, and tendons and flesh appeared on them. Finally, God had Ezekiel command the breath of life to enter the bodies, and they came to life. God told Ezekiel the meaning of the vision. These bones are the whole house of Israel. I am going to open your graves and bring you up from them. I will bring you back to the land of Israel. Then you will know that I am God.
Well, hey, hey, it's good to see you this morning. Welcome to Stonesill Community Church. I'm Pastor Joey, and it's a privilege to welcome you here today on this Mother's Day. I commend you mothers for the job well done. You've loved your family and cared for them and parented them and nurtured them. And as we saw earlier, you've made good meals for them. You've provided Cheez-Its, delicious Cheez-Its for them. And that's awesome. I don't have any Cheez-Its for you here this morning, but I'm sure if you ask your mom, she'd probably get you some Cheez-Its here on this Mother's Day weekend. But I commend you. You're doing a great job. I want you to know that. Maybe you need to hear that today. And I commend you for those of you who have already expressed gratitude for your mother today. What an awesome, awesome deal. She'll always remember the things that you do for her and the things that you get her and things, but she will especially remember the words that you share. So always take time to put words to how you feel about your mama, because she'll love that and she'll cherish those words. I commend you also for being here and staying with this series. We are in chapter 17 of what's been a great series. And if you're new here at Stones Hill and everything, we want you to know that there's a methodical plan when we do series like this from time to time. We'll do special topical series, and then we'll do a biblical book series and things. And so this is a place you can trust that will commit to that priority. And so that's a good thing, isn't it? But we're in a series right now. It's kind of an overall view and storyline of the Bible. And so we're looking at the plot line of the Bible. We're seeing how God is self-disclosed, or He's revealed Himself, something about Himself, in the larger story in the Bible. And there is a meta-narrative, there's a larger story in our world. It's not just little things that we do day to day, and that's the essence of life. No, this thing is bigger, and it's bolder, and it splashes beyond just the day-to-day. And God is at work in history, and He's sovereign, and He's going to make sure that things resolve where they need to resolve. Okay, and there's times in our story where, even our personal stories, there's times when kind of negative stuff happens. And God can use the negative stuff to embed promises, words of hope, words of healing, and the opportunity to begin again out of the ashes of what you thought was the life that you wanted to live. Okay? And that's the power and sovereignty and the grace of our God. And that'll preach right there. The old-time evangelist used to say, that'll preach. Well, that will preach right there. The fact that the kingdoms fall and our lives fall. And chapter 17, the kingdoms fall is the title of our chapter in the story. And boy, that happens a lot of times in our lives. But we mustn't despair. If you've had some great fall in your life, if you've had some great mistake in your life, you've made some major decisions that haven't really, wasn't the best decisions to make, that God is still embedded in our crises, and He works, and He plans, and He moves, and He persuades. He uses free will human decisions, but He also uses His sovereign plan to guide things along, to get you back where you need to be. And so I just want to encourage you with those words. Maybe some of you moms feel threatened by the fact that maybe I didn't do the best with that particular parental decision. And maybe this didn't go the way I planned it to go. I just want to encourage you that God's still at work. And He's going to work in the lives of your kids. And He's going to work in your family. And we just want you to feel the love today and know that you're loved and cared for. And not just you today, not just the mothers, but you men as well. Maybe there's visitors here today. You're just kind of here on Mother's Day. And maybe there's some stuff in your story that you just really need to surrender to God. And trust Him to guide and direct in this. And so I don't know what burdens you might be carrying. And I'll tell you what, I'll make a deal with you at the end of the service today. I know probably everybody's anxious to go and be have lunch with their families and things, and you're certainly going to be invited to do that, and I'm sure you'll enjoy that. But we will have just a little time of prayer today here before you go. And so if you care to and you're here and you're facing some life event, what we just encourage you to do at the end of the service, just come up, and I'll give you the opportunity to do that. And we'll pray for you, because some of you got some tough news this week. I'm sure you did. It happens every week. There are questions that we struggle with, and on every Sunday morning, people walk into this place with questions to which they have no answers. And they need the prayers of the people of God. And so we'll invite you to do that today. You can be thinking about that. But one of the commitments I make is I have chosen to lead point on this storytelling proposition that we have here in front of you each week. I'm kind of pulling this thing along with the help of so many of discussion group leaders, small group leaders, videos, just so many are contributing to this journey, this story journey that we're on. But this morning I realized I'm kind of the engine on this thing. I got to carry it, move it forward. And so today I feel like that maybe we need to focus on the words of Jeremiah. And we need to look at Jeremiah the prophet and an experience that he had, some words that he shared, because when the kingdom falls, there's major things that happen. And so the question is, how are we going to live while we are in our exiled state? How are we going to live as the people of God? Our temple's been destroyed, and it was. Our nation's identity has been threatened, and it was. The holidays and festivals we used to celebrate, we can't celebrate anymore. We have been uprooted, shipped 1,200, 1,500 miles away to a foreign city, and now the question is, how are we supposed to live there now? How are we supposed to tell the story? How are we supposed to advance the plot line? What's God's purpose for us now? He called us to do something special. He called us to be messengers of the great story of the ages to the world. And our own nation could not even continue to exist because we collapsed in on ourselves because of our moral problems and moral failures. So that's the question we have in front of us. And there were three people, agendas that are represented in Jeremiah chapter 29. And so just let me go back and share with you a little bit of the backstory here. If you're reading through the book, the story, on pages 231 and 247 are your reference pages. I realize some of you may be bringing that with you to church, and so I just reference the pages for you. But if you've been coming for tracking in this series, you know that Israel went through a divide. There's the Northern Kingdom, Southern Kingdom. I won't go into the details of that. But the Northern Kingdom falls to the nation of Syria in 722 BC. In 586, the great Babylonian superpower, they had conquered the Assyrians after the Assyrians had defeated northern kingdom of Israel in 722 BC. Okay, the new world superpower, the Babylonians, had conquered Assyria in the meantime. About 150 some odd years later, 586 BC, now the Babylonian foreign invading power is coming down in on the southern kingdom of Israel, known as the kingdom of Judah, and they surround it. And they conquer it, and they have a brutal, brutal policy. And that is that when they go into these cities, they have a policy of deportation. And so the leading citizens, Daniel among them, we'll see more about him next week in the installment of the story. But they are shipped out of the promised land. They're shipped out of Israel. And they're moved into this big, brutal, strange city along with other exiles. And Jeremiah the prophet prepared them on how to live in their exiled state. And that's a very special thing that God did for the nation of Israel and the people of Judah. Is he gives them special instructions on how to live because it was difficult. It's very disorienting. Imagine if you were uprooted. Somebody showed up and said, you know, you're leaving your house and everything behind. Carry what you can on your back and that's all you can bring. Let's go. And that's literally what happened. They carried what they could and they were off and going and life was a brand new world to them. And so they're trying to figure out how in the world are we supposed to live now? And so let me read through these verses, and I'll try to read through quickly here just to lay out the terrain, and then I'll kind of go back and we'll look at these three different agendas for living in exile. Slide number 5, let's just skip a few. Slide number 5, verse 4, this is what the Lord Almighty, the God of Israel, says to all those I carried into exile from Jerusalem to Babylon. Build houses, settle down. Plant gardens. And eat what they produce. Slide 6. Marry and have sons and daughters. Find wives for your sons and give your daughters in marriage so that they too may have sons and daughters. Increase in number there. Do not decrease. You want to know how to live in exile today? He's telling you. Maybe you felt disoriented. Maybe you feel like you're in an exiled place of life. You're waiting on something to happen or waiting on this to transpire or this opportunity to open up. You're not sure what to do. Where to now? Life's been devastated. What do I do? Jeremiah's telling you what we do. Okay? When we feel like we're in a place we don't belong anymore. He's telling us what to do. Verse 7, also seek the peace and prosperity of the city to which I have carried you into exile. Pray to the Lord for it, because if it prospers, you too will prosper. Yes, this is what the Lord Almighty, the God of Israel, says. Do not let the prophets and diviners among you deceive you. Do not listen to the dreams you encourage them to have. They are prophesying lies to you in my name. I have not sent them, declares the Lord. Slide 7, verse 10. This is what the Lord says. When 70 years are completed for Babylon, I will come to you and fulfill my good promise to bring you back to this place. Of course, the false prophets were saying a much shorter period of time. And Jeremiah the prophet, known as a weeping prophet, set aside from his mother's womb. That's a Mother's Day message that we'll preach. All right? For I know the plans I have for you. Jeremiah the prophet writes, and the Lord declares, and you've seen this on greeting cards, you've used it on your Facebook posts, this is a very special verse coming up. I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans to prosper you and not to harm you. Plans to give you hope and a future. The Lord assured the people that what had happened was not a random series of unplanned, accidental events. No, that God somehow was in the planning of fallen, free will, human creatures' decisions. His plan was in fact not intended to hurt them in the long run, but to give them hope and a future. And it was these words that Jeremiah the prophet felt compelled to share. In verse 12, then you will call on me and come and pray to me, and I will listen to you. You will seek me and find me when you seek me with all your heart. I will be found by you, declares the Lord, and will bring you back from captivity. I will gather you from all the nations and places where I have banished you, declares the Lord, and will bring you back to the place from which I carried you into exile. So you've got three agendas in our text. Three agendas, three viewpoints of how you're to live in exile. How they were to live in an exile state. You had the Babylonians, and they had an agenda. Here's what we want you to do. Here's how we want you to conform. Here's how we want you to assimilate. More about that in a second. The second agenda, the false prophets. What were they trying to say? Well, it's going to be a short stay. Don't settle into where you're going. You're only going to be there a few months and you're going to get to go back. Jeremiah the prophet says, no, sir, it's not going to happen that way. I got a word from God, and God declares it's a minimum of 70 years. Mentally prepare yourself. Face reality. And so he has to correct the agenda of the false prophets. And then you have a third agenda. It's God's agenda, Jeremiah's agenda. And he basically says, carry on with your life. Live a God-glorifying life where you are, and here's how you can live that God-glorifying life. So the first agenda was the agenda of the Babylonians. Babylon had brought the Jewish exiles, and they had an agenda for what they wanted the Jewish exiles to do. The Babylonians were expert geniuses in how to conquer and defeat nations, such that they wouldn't come back and pose a problem later, as many nations were apt to do. So they're experts. They know how to deal with subjugated, conquered people. And the first way they did, and they tried, was expulsion. We'll just drive them out, and we'll drive them out of their nations, and we'll just see if that works. And of course, they tried that for a while, and that's not going to work, because when you expel someone, and there's a policy of expulsion, you drive them out, and it just gives them time to regroup, and then once they regroup, they come back. So the Babylonians are like, that's not going to work. They tried expulsion. The Babylonians tried to exclude and to oppress people through subjugation. We'll subjugate them. We'll just push them down. We won't just drive them out. We'll push them down, and we'll enslave them, and we'll chain them up, and we'll make them do menial labor and that sort of thing. And you just kind of whip them into submission. And there's a problem with that approach too, because not only in expulsion, they regroup and come back as a nation. If you subjugate them, some rebel leader is going to say, in some heroic voice, is going to say, we are no longer going to bow to your demands, and we're going to rally the troops. We're going to have a quick put together a resistance to this great onslaught of oppression the Babylonians are imposing, and we're going to conquer you guys. We're going to take you out. And so the Babylonians had tried to do it that way, and it never worked. So they tried expulsion, they tried subjugation, and then finally, the way that seemed to work best was assimilation. Here's what we'll do. We're not going to exclude you. We're not necessarily going to drive you out. Rather, we are going to relocate you, but here's what we're going to do. We're going to give you a good job while you're here. We'll give you a good job. We'll pay you your, like we pay all of our native Babylonians. You just come into Babylon and you be like us. Assimilate. Don't rock the boat. Know your place. Okay? Don't remember who brought you here, who's in control, but we'll give you a job. We'll let you live your life. Just assimilate. Forget your identity. Become one of us. You see? And that was what the Babylonian policy became. That's the method for subjugating, not just subjugating and expelling nations. That was the method for becoming a world superpower. And that's what worked for them. We'll educate you like we did Daniel. We'll educate you. We'll give you advancement opportunities like they did Daniel. Daniel, who was one of the captives, exiles, he went on to do some pretty powerful things in the nation of Babylon. represented God there, but he didn't forget who he was. And see, you and I today are in the very, very similar situation. That we live in a world with an agenda. And there's people with agendas in our world. But perhaps the thing that's going to be the most challenging for you moms as you're trying to raise your family, okay, let's just apply it to you today. It seems appropriate. You moms trying to raise your family, if you want to really raise your family and orient them to be a powerful witness for God, you got to tell them who they are. You got to tell them what God made them and why he made them and the purpose he has for human beings in this life. You moms and you dads got to chime in there too and lead the way. You've got to give them an identity that no matter where they are, no matter what nation they're in, no matter what families they're a part of or what groups they're a part of or what college campuses they may be on or what jobs they may take or what factory floor they represent the name of the Lord on, it is our job as parents to instill the sense of identity, and that while we blend in and we work hard and we hold down jobs and we marry and we give birth and we build homes and we do all of these things, we mustn't forget who we are and whose we are and who we represent. And this is a very important point to make. And so the Babylonians said, you know, just assimilate intellectually, assimilate socially and culturally and spiritually. All right, and within a couple of generations, we won't ever hear from those Israelis again. They'll just be one of us. They'll just blend right in. And they'll be a part of our group. Expulsion's never worked long term. Subjugation's never worked long term. But this assimilation thing does the trick. And boy, that was their agenda. Now there's a second group in the text that had another agenda. Their agenda was, we could call it tribalism. One pastor I was reading on this called it tribalism. Tribalism, the false prophets said, no, don't enjoy the new nation that you're in, the new nation that you've become. Don't blend in like that. You're more of a tribe. You got to maintain a sense of separateness or distinction, isolation from the culture in which you're in. And so these false prophets were saying things that were contrary to what God's plan was, prophesying lies, verse 9, in his name, and misleading the people. And the prophets were saying, you guys don't get at home in the nation of Babylon. Don't just really move in there, okay? Stay out here on the edges and we'll have our little ethnic enclaves and we'll just maintain our little distinctives out here in our little villages and our little towns and our little culturally distinct places. We'll have a little Israel right here in the middle of this big metropolis of Babylon. And we won't really touch their lives, and we won't let their lives touch ours, and that's how we're going to approach this. And that's the agenda of the false prophets. See, assimilation means you go into the city and you just lose all distinctives, and you become one in the culture like everybody else. You never buck anything. You never stand for anything. You never stand for the true definition of marriage. You never stand for the true gender of God, of who God made us to be. You just blend in and go along and just, yeah, okay, whatever. And I'll just make my paycheck and I'll just kind of let things flow. I'll just kind of join the circus with everybody else. That's one approach. False prophets approach. No, don't let any of that stuff touch you. It's tribalism. Let's let it live on the outside. We might smile at everybody, but we're going to live at disdain and we're going to resent the fact that we are where we are. And we're going to let everybody know it. That's what the false prophets said to do. Don't move into the city. Don't be friendly with your neighbors. Exploit the city, use the city, disdain the city, and then get the heck out of it. We can't stand it here in this place and where we are. See, the Babylonians said, come on in. Take your shoes off, be right at home. Don't rock the boat. The false prophet said, don't touch that culture. It's evil. It's awful. You've messed up. God's will for your life is forever shattered, forever ruined. And sometimes we feel that way, don't we? Man, I'll never get God's will now after all that. Now, come on. God's bigger than that. He's bigger than our harebrained decisions, okay? He can work despite our free will human rebellion decisions. He can work. Jeremiah was a voice of hope and all that. But see, God has a different agenda. And that's the third agenda represented in our text here this morning. It's not just assimilation, forgetting who we are. It's not just tribalism, not being touched by that decadent culture. No. God says, Jeremiah says, through God's words to him, and he is the mouthpiece of God, set aside from his mother's womb, he says in Jeremiah 1. A good Mother's Day text. He set aside from his mother's womb. God calls little babies, sometimes from the womb. And they are babies in the womb. They're human beings. The Bible frame of reference is very clear about that. In fact, some of you moms may have a sense. Just be open to that. Of just, God, what might it be that you are laying on my heart that this baby boy or this baby girl, what might be your purpose for their life? And begin to pray about that. And maybe God will guide you and you'll see things in that little baby's life. And you can begin to steer them in a direction that where they can hear the voice of God. And maybe there'll be Jeremiah, a weeping prophet. Maybe there'll be Ezekiel and prophesy and have a message of hope as well. You never know how God might use them. But moms and dads, be alert to this. God does call from the womb forward sometimes. And so what is God's agenda for us? We who feel like maybe we're exiles in a nation that we kind of hard to really know our nation anymore. Maybe you're in a family where it's kind of, you feel like an exile in your family. Maybe you're in a community, you feel like an exile. You feel all alone, you're disoriented. You just need somebody almost to kind of lead you through it. And that's what we're about, and that's what God's about, and that's what I'm about here this morning. I want to encourage you and exhort you how to live in exile. Wherever you are and whatever your situation. Some of you young people maybe feel like you're exiled, and maybe you didn't have a prom date last night. And you feel exiled, and you feel alone, and you're just like, well, what am I supposed to do? I don't have a date. And maybe some of you middle-aged or young adults are trying to get to the job you want to get in. You're not there yet, and you feel exiled in fact, you're working jobs you didn't even get your degree in. And so maybe you feel a sense of exile. Maybe you're in a marriage that's broken. You feel exile. See, this is how what are we supposed to do in exile? Well, God addresses this because really life is like an exile here at times. And really our whole human existence. We are exiles. We're moving through. But yet God gives us a purpose, a purpose and some things to commit ourselves to while we're in these exilic places. And we see on slide number 5, if we go back to slide number 5, we see what God says to do in our exile places. And I love this. Build houses. That's a job. In other words, if you build a house, some of you guys have built houses and you've done such a great job, and praise God you've been able to pull that off, but you were so busy and it's a lot of tedious stuff. And you know when you go to the work to build a house, you plan on staying in it a little while, right? I'm building this thing. I mean, may sell it somewhere down the road, but right now I'm here for a while because it was hard work. And when you build a house, what's it saying? Well, we're going to settle down here. 70 years, Jeremiah said. False prophet said shorter. No, we're going to settle down. We're going to build houses. He says, settle down. Settle down. Calm down. Don't get up in a tizzy. Okay? Plant gardens. That means you're going to be there a while. You intend to see them come to fruition. Eat what they produce. Season after season. Verse 6, marry and have sons and daughters. Find wives for your sons and give your daughters in marriage so that they too may have sons and daughters. And notice it's sons and daughters, okay? Increase in number there, do not decrease. Also seek the peace and prosperity of the city to which I have carried you into exile. Pray to the Lord for it, because if it prospers, you too will prosper. See, Jeremiah's message was not a message of assimilation. Lose your distinctives. Lose your sense of family and identity. Lose your sense of purpose in life. Lose your vision of being a carrier of the story. See, that's not his message. That's the Babylonian message. And on the other hand, Jeremiah's message was, don't get all tribal and become an isolationist and pull away and separate from and dig the moats and fill them in with water and shut the doors and not let the world impact you in any way. No, not ever. That wasn't Jeremiah's message. And look with self-righteousness and disdain on your neighbors. That's not Jeremiah's message. See, Jeremiah's message, I want you to remember who you are, where you came from, who your true God is. I want you to remember the definition, the true definition of marriage, back when it was really right. I want you to remember what family means. I want you to remember who God is. I want you to remember His story. I want you to live from that story. Tell your kids that story. Live that story. No matter where you are, whatever college campus you're on, whatever city you live in, whatever job you take, whatever family you marry into, you maintain you are a carrier of the story. That's your identity. You're made in the image of God. You belong to Him. The devil didn't make you. God did. You belong to Him. And now let's live in light of this great story. Don't lose it. You see, that's what Jeremiah says. And Jeremiah says, furthermore, if you ever want to have a credible hearing in these foreign places that you find yourself, again, college campuses, jobs, cities, new communities you're a part of, if you want to have a credible hearing, if you want to be the best, here's how you can have a credible hearing. Be the best parent you can be, Jeremiah says. Be the best mom you can be. Love those kids and mentor them and pour into them the sense of truth. And like I said, some of your moms are just doing an outstanding job of that. If you want to be a credible voice for God and the story when you're in these less than ideal places and phases of life, invest in your marital partner. Have a great marriage, Jeremiah says. Marry each other and thrive in that relationship, no matter who's elected or who the leaders may be or who seems to be winning in the great realm of the marketplace of ideas and political debate and agendas and various propositions are floating for the world. No matter who, you have a good marriage. You parent your children well. That's something you can do. You may vote one way and it seems like it always goes the other way, but praise God, you're married. You can invest in that marriage partner. You can invest in your children and raise them to love God and have an identity in God. If you're a son or daughter, you can love your mama and your daddy. If you're a neighbor, you can be a good neighbor and maybe invite them over or share a hamburger from time to time or just a conversation here or there. You can be a good community member. You're not going to assimilate. You're not going to isolate and get all tribal. No, you're going to do it God's way. And you're going to know who you are, and yet you're going to position yourself to be a credible witness to the story of the ages. The story, the great story of what God is doing in the world. Someone I consulted reminded me this week of St. Augustine's observation. He says, the world is basically a tale of two cities. It's a tale of two cities. The whole history of the world can be summed up as a tale of two cities. We see them contrasted. We see them contrasted in the Bible. And you can kind of see it in history. There's the city of Babylon. And the city of Babylon is versus the city of Jerusalem. And it's a very good observation. You see, Babylon is a city of man. And Augustine would contend that this city, this figurative city, tale of two cities in the world, figurative city is about pride. It's about everyone trying to make a name for themselves in the city of Babylon. If you live and you drive your identity from the city of Babylon, you're going to want love and recognition and notoriety. And there's nothing wrong with wanting love. Nothing wrong with some godly ambition and recognition and notoriety when used for the glory of God. But in Babylon, most of the time, it's not used for the glory of God. And so we want an identity and we work hard to create it. And somehow we can go too far and think, well, my identity is where I live and what I live in. It's what I drive. It's the job I have. It's these little tokens of identity that we kind of attach ourselves to. And that's the way we do it in Babylon. That's the way the citizens of Babylon operate. In contrast to Babylon, there's another city. And it's the city of Jerusalem. It's the city of God. It's where God, in grace, pours Himself out for the world. And in that, we have a new identity. We have a new citizenship. It's in God alone who loved me enough to die for me. I can trust His justice. I can know joy and peace. It's found in the city of Jerusalem. And we offer our lives not because we're trying to selfishly accomplish these goals in life and these tokens of identity. No, we offer our lives because our Savior offered His. And we understand when we live and are citizens in the city of Jerusalem, we have a story of God and we are called to be messengers of the story. And so when God says, move into Babylon and seek its peace, this is what He means. He means that we would maintain our identity even though we live in the Babylons of the world. You know, years after Jeremiah wrote, Jesus explained what Jeremiah was driving at. He said in Matthew 5, in the middle of the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus Christ says to His disciples, "You are a city on a hill. Let your light shine before men that they may see your good deeds and praise your Father in heaven." Here's what He's saying. He says, every human city has both the earthly city and the city of God in it. Even our town, Ligonier, Ligonier, right? Ligon Wall, all right? Here we are. There's two cities in Ligon Wall, all right? Two cities. There's a city of God that's is a mini city within the bigger city, all right? There's the city, and then there's the mini city within the bigger city. And the mini city is the church. We could call it the church, the new community. And you are in the process of letting people know that the great story of the ages is credible. How are you letting them know it's a credible story? Loving your wife, loving your husband, parenting well, building houses, settling in, becoming a part, praying blessings, God blessing on the city that you live in. This is how you do it. This is how we become credible. This is how it works in the city of God. The mini city within the bigger cities of the world. And that's what Jesus says. Christians are to be an alternate city in every city. And so when we take the three biggies of life, sex and money and power, and we look at how Babylon handles those three biggies of life, it's kind of a trio of the biggies. Sex and money and power. And you look at how Babylon treats those things. And sex becomes exploitative. And money becomes a selfish driven thing. And power can get destructive in the Babylons of the world. But when we look at the alternate city that it's in every city, we can see how the church handles these three big, the trio of the three biggies. And sex, instead of twisting it and using it for our own selfish consumption, instead we decide that sex is something that builds better marriages. And we use it for that purpose. You see, the city of Babylon will never give you that message. But here at Stones Hill Community Church, the city within the city, the mini city within the bigger city, we champion messages like that. And we let you know that this is a gift from God to build a better marriage. Money in the city of Babylon is used to destroy and to feed pride and many times and to insulate ourselves against maybe God's plans and purposes. But money in the city of God builds churches. It pays off debt so that churches are positioned to buck the Babylonian influence in the culture of our world when we need to buck it. But also to be equipped to engage it, to be a part of it, and to touch it in a Christ-exalting way. Power. Instead of Babylon uses power for its own ends, to do its own bidding. But power in the little mini city of God is the grace to do the right thing. No matter how culture tells you to do it differently. And Jesus says, here's what you're supposed to be doing. The way you bear witness in the earthly city to God's heavenly city is you don't work in the city for your own sake or your tribe's sake. If you go into the city or the town or the factories to work for your sake, you're going to eventually assimilate and you'll be doing what everybody else does in a short period of time. If you go into the city and you get all tribal, if you go into your new neighborhoods, you get all tribal, and you're going to disdain your neighbors, and you're going to communicate the message that, you know what, I'm here for a little while, but I can't stand it here, I'm leaving as soon as I can. It's not going to position you to be a credible witness. St. Augustine says that instead of these things, you know, the moment you're born into the kingdom of God, that you have this dual citizenship, and you're a citizen of the city of God, and you're a citizen of the earthly city of the Babylons of the world. And they are the, and Christ followers are the best citizens. They have the best marriages. They do the best job parenting. They do the best things with their money. They use sex in a way that's right. They use power in a way that extends and glorifies the kingdom of God. And you're a part of it. You're a part of the mini city within the cities of the world. And I want to challenge you this morning not to assimilate. I want to challenge you this morning not to tribalize despite how current cultural trends may go. I want you to get married. Raise a family. Build houses. But stay distinct. Be different. Keep your beliefs. Keep your practices. Even though they may be people may be offended. They may be offended if you insist that you conform to the biological gender of your birth certificate. Imagine that. Put that pastor in jail. He's insisting that I conform to my gender for my birth certificate. And you believe the audacity? It said I'm male and he's going to insist that I'm still male? Oh, this is just awful. Oh, just awful, right? Okay. Little drama for the road. Isn't it crazy? Did you ever think it would become illegal to insist that you would just conform to your birth gender? Yeah. Are we living in Babylon or what, church? We are there. And so but you're not a Babylonian. You are a Christ follower. Don't you forget your identity. I don't care what the gender restroom signs read. God made you male, you operate from that. God made you female, you operate from that. You know, I went into a gender neutral bathroom coming back from the Christmas trip. And you had male here and you had female here, and then you had one in the middle. And it said gender neutral or whatever. And I opened the door. I mean, it was so much more spacious than the other two. It's like I looked around. Okay, no Stone Hill Community Church people here. I went in. Boo! Shut the door and locked it, okay? It's a one horse deal in there, okay? So I went in. It's like, man, this is nice. You know, if they made every bathroom like this, you know, one person, go in, lock the door behind you. Who cares? But, you know, male or female, doesn't matter. You're in there by yourself. Lock the door. Everybody has a right to go to the bathroom. Number one, number two, we got a right. Okay, we got a right to do that. But we don't have a right to jeopardize people, parents and families that are trying to do a good job with their little daughters and their little sons. And we don't have a right to put them in places of vulnerability where people are going to capitalize on a ridiculous law. And you watch North Carolina. North Carolina is now, you thought the target? They're now the bullseye. Draw a circle around that because they're going after them hard and heavy from the top. You watch what happens there. Because that's going to become a test case for the other states. You live in Babylon, but you are not a Babylonian. You are a Christ follower. And that's your identity. And you heard it here, and you heard it from the Word of God. Don't tribalize, though. If you got to go, number one or number two, I don't care what sign's on the door. I've been in those situations. And when you got to go, you got to go. And God's grace will just have to cover it. Okay? But as a general rule, when we start making policy, behavior will exploit the loopholes in the policy. And then you've got ridiculous leadership who actually supports this kind of stuff. And before long, you realize that you feel like an exile in your own country. And that's where it's going to go. But don't you give up hope. Pastor, what am I supposed to do? Romance somebody. You young men, romance a gal that loves the Lord. She's a godly, sexy woman of God. And she just walked with Jesus. And she's bold enough to say, you know what? I know what sex is for. It's to build better marriages. And we're not going there until you get a hold. God brings you somebody like that. You start praying, boys, and work out that proposal. Because she's a keeper. Okay? Because she knows who she is. Some of you boys on the reverse, you can know who you are. Some of the girls want you to put out, right? Put out, put out, put out. And if you don't, you're not a man. Well, you just look at her in the eye and you tell her, I value you too much. I know who I am. I'm in another kingdom. I have drives and I have passions like everybody else. But I'm not going to disrespect you. I'm not going to treat you that way. And if she has any sense at all, she'll go home and repent and realign her priorities in life. Just in one example, I could give like dozens of things like that. But you're going to have to let the Spirit apply this. You are in Babylon, but you are not a Babylonian. You are not to assimilate. You are in Babylon, but you are not to tribalize. No, you are a mini city within the city. You are the church. You are to engage. You are to pray shalom. It's a comprehensive Hebrew word. It takes in all aspects of life, political, social, economic, relational. Shalom. You are to contribute to the shalom in your family and community. You are to be the carriers of the great story of the ages. You see, these are great words for all of us who feel a bit of exile in the world. Again, we see leadership transitions where power seems to pass to those with an agenda harmful to so many. We see laws that get passed with which we strongly disagree. We read about major crimes committed, and then justice is flaunted through legal wrangling. We endeavor to be a voice for the voiceless, yet those voices rarely ever get heard outside of the personal social media venues that we often have to use to make our voice heard. What should we do? What should our focus be, Pastor? Should we get violent and attack an extreme case of tribalism? Should we go into isolation and stockpile camping food? A soft case of tribalism. Should we just cave in and go with the flow and join the circus? A very clear case of assimilation. You know what Jeremiah says? Slide number 6. Mary, have sons and daughters, and raise those sons and daughters, orient them to the story, find wives for your sons and give your daughters in marriage so that they too may have sons and daughters. Increase in number there, do not decrease. Also, seek the peace and prosperity of the city. You know what? I'm in Babylon. I'll do my best to make Babylon better, but I'm not a Babylonian. But make it better. Pray to the Lord for it, because if it prospers, you too will prosper. And so we are to engage in our world. Go ahead and vote in elections. Run for offices. Write better laws. Produce better films. Author inspirational music. Bear in mind, though, that we are exiles here. And the values and the priorities of the mini city that lives within the bigger city, the Jerusalem that lives in the Babylonian environment, larger context, that sometimes our voice will be heard, sometimes it will not be. But what does God tell us to value when the world goes to pieces, it seemingly goes to pieces like this? Love your wife. Love your husband. Invest in your children. Build houses. Work a good job as best you can for the glory of God. And do that day in and day out faithfully. If I could give you 3 application points, you got to face reality. The world's not what it used to be. And you got to face that. And you can't just keep fighting that. It's changed. It is changing. And we have to face reality. And when we face reality, you got to realize that God has a plan. Like Jeremiah the prophet said, He's got a plan. And this is not just mere accidental things that's happening. Sometimes God uses things in remarkable ways to accomplish things. So face reality. Second thing is carry on with your life. I'll say it again. Get married, build houses, live in them, raise a family, work a job, be a good citizen. Carry on. Don't give up. Just carry on faithfully and share the story with others when given the opportunity to do so. Finally, I would just say to you, plan for the future. So face reality, carry on, plan for the future. Plan for the future. God said to plant gardens and eat what they produce. Sometimes it's tempting to get bogged down in the ugly details of life. And it may be difficult to visualize what a better tomorrow will be, but that's what the church is about. We can create a better future. A better way to use sex, power, and money. A better way to use our abilities and resources. We author that, or we champion the cause of that in the church. We are little Jerusalemites. We are a mini city of God in the bigger Babylons of the world. You know, God is so good. He's just talking to me more and more, kind of out there on the trail or on the road or wherever I happen to be. And He's just really working in my life, and I just praise Him for it. And I think one of my passions for Stones Hill is that we really understand the message I'm giving to you today. Because I want you to engage in the world. I want you to be good coaches and teachers and factory workers and bus drivers and food services people and grounds and maintenance persons and executives and legal and political and all these things. I just feel like that the church, the way we stand to change the world is we raise up men and women in families, in churches, who have the values, the biblical worldview, and then they go live that out where they live and where they work. I felt that for a long time. And God's been just driving that home to me wherever I happen to be. He's been at work in my life. And sometimes it's a hard thing to try to figure out as a pastor. Where do I need to guide the people? What do we need to, you know, how can we reorient our viewpoint here and get on target? And I think this is where we need to go, church. This is where we need to go. Let's have the best families we can possibly have, the best marriages we can possibly have, raising some of the best young people we could possibly raise, preparing them to be the best workers they could possibly be, the best students they can possibly be, the best soldiers they can possibly be. Wherever they go, whatever they do, that this would be our mantra, this would be our goal. So you help me pray to this end today. There's more things here to share with you, but it'll wait to another time. I want you to have some time with your family today. So I want to wrap it up here with just shape an invitation. So here comes Jesus Christ into the city of God, into the city of Jerusalem, about 2,000 years ago. What happens to him there? He's executed. He's thrown out. And you know, you never executed somebody inside the city. You took them outside the city, and then you put the spikes through their wrists, and you hung them up as a living Roman billboard. You defy Rome. This is what happens to you. They kind of like to use it that way. But why did you execute criminals outside the city? It was a symbolic act of banishment. And the exile that sins deserves, they were going to impose that on the person being executed. The consequence of selfishness and sin is exile. And so you lose the safety, you lose the community, you're thrown out. And you see, Jesus Christ, ironically, went into the city of God, the Jerusalem. He went in the city of God, and he was killed, and he was thrown out. The most perfect person that ever lived was thrown out. But it wasn't a symbol with Jesus. It was a reality. Hebrews says that Jesus suffered outside the city gate to make the people holy through his own blood. For here we do not have an enduring city, but we are looking for the city that is to come. Jesus suffered outside the gate. What does that mean? On the cross, Jesus was forsaken. He was thrown out, as it were. He was forsaken by God, as it were. He lost the Father, as it were. He experienced hell, as it were, on the cross. And we'll put it this way this morning as we close. Jesus Christ was thrown out of the city of God so you and I could be brought in. That's what the gospel's about. Jesus Christ, righteous in every way, thrown out of the city of God so people like you and me, many times Babylonians at heart, could be brought in. Why? He got the punishment. He got the banishment. He got the exile. Sin deserves to be thrown out of the city, but Jesus Christ took it for us. And so when you believe in Jesus, you're automatically enrolled in the city of God, and you become a citizen of the city of God. Listen, Jesus lost the city so that you and I could become citizens of a city to come. And that makes us salt and light in the city. And why? Well, if you know who you are, if you have a sense of self and identity in God, if you have the love of God, then you move out of the earthly city. You don't necessarily stand in need of it anymore. You're in one, but you don't have to have it. And instead, you're ready to give. You're ready to go where God calls. You're ready to do what God bids you to do. And so how are we to look at the city we're exiled in, filled with people who are believing the wrong things and doing the wrong things? It's never assimilation. It's never tribalism. When Jesus died on the cross, He was dying for me, and even though I deeply differed with Him, He died for me, He loved me, and He empowers me to go out into the city of man and the Babylons of the world and serve and love people deeply, even people I may differ with. And that, men and women, is the calling of the church. It's our call. And so today, as I've shared with you, some of you are moms and you want to do a better job, and maybe you walked in here today and you've never really seen yourself as a citizen of God, a child of God, and maybe you're here today and you'd like to turn your life over to the Lord. We're going to dismiss the group because some people have Mother's Day dinners to get to and things, but if you'd like to delay and you're leaving just for a few moments and come forward at the end of my prayer, I'm going to hang out up front here. I'm going to pray with you today. And not just mothers, but anybody here who happens to see the truth of what I'm seeing. And maybe God's tugged at your heart. And He's like, yeah, the Lord spoke to me and I need to go. There's something, as a mother, I got a concern maybe. I need to have the church pray for me. So you feel free to do that after we pray. Do we have an announcement in the back? Yes. Oh, good. Awesome. Thank you. Yes. Happy Mother's Day to each of you. I hope you enjoy your day. And let's pray together, okay? All right. Thank you, God, for this day. And thank you for your great love and grace. It's one of those sermons that just really sets the pace. It sharpens the lens of how we are to approach life as exiles in the culture that we feel exiled from. And so I just ask and pray that we would walk out of this place with a new resolve. And help us just not to remember to say thank you to our moms today, but I think there's maybe some husbands here who need to look at their wives and give them a hug and say, I love you. And that's my first step toward being a citizen in the city of God and doing something good for the world. And maybe there are some wives that need to look at their husband and say, you know, you got to forgive me. I have been so bullheaded. I have so been disrespectful to you. I want you to forgive me. Maybe that's the next first step here for somebody. We've got some young people that are exiled, feel disoriented, disconnected, no identity. Pray today that they would feel your love and be embraced by your grace. We've got some people, students coming in, going out, people graduating, going to different places to live. I just ask and pray you would rivet in their heart and mind who they are and who they represent, and that they would know that we're here cheering for them to represent the city of God and the cities of man. And then I just pray for the one that just kind of wandered in today. They haven't even tracked with the story. They really don't know all the things that went before. Not sure what's to come after. But they came in, they sat down, and something said, touch them. And maybe it's that part about where Jesus was excluded. Outside of the righteous city of Jerusalem. He was excluded for me and for them. And maybe we have some here that's felt excluded their whole life. Mommy and daddy loved somebody else in the family. They didn't love them. A spouse, after a few years of marriage, said no to them and they went another way and they felt excluded and exiled. Maybe someone that got terminated, or maybe someone feels excluded from life and living because of these of the health prognosis and things that's come through in the last few months or years even. God, I pray you would just go to them right now. And the words of the prophet, they would hear echoing, I have plans not to harm you, but to bless you, to give you a hope and a future. But no matter how many days you have been in your exile state, I am working. I have a plan. I have a plan and I am working. And it is my hope and my dream for your life that you're around to eat the fruit and reap the benefits of the produce because of what I'm going to do in your life to restore you to a place of health and strength. God, whomever is here that needs these words, drive it on through their hearts in Jesus' name. Amen. Hey, you're dismissed. Thank you for your kind attention. Again, I'm hanging around up front for just a few more moments. If you want to come up and pray about something, feel free, okay?